Okay, so any queries from the last lecture? Or if you want to discuss something regarding the programming assignments? When I get so many emails and when I ask you in person, I receive no response. Anything which you want to discuss? Can we start if you are done with your mobile phones? Okay. So regarding the programming assignments, if you have implemented third and fourth programming assignments in some other language other than C or C++, it is okay. But from now on, you are expected to submit all the assignments in either C or C++. So no Python or Java. Or shell. Thank you. Okay. So what did we do last week? Can someone remind me? Semaphores. Okay. So people on the second desk, Q3, you are actually distracting me. Okay, so before continuing, I want to clarify a few things. So one is a mistake from my side, which I made the last week. I'll clarify that. And one more point I wanted to clarify. So I'm presuming there is some confusion on that part. Okay, so the first software solution which we discussed to synchronization, it was the software solution. We looked at the Peterson solution, which looked quite involved. And then we came up with this concept of locks, and we have written this code. So any program before starting is going to share this shared variable, which is lock, which initially is false, which means lock is not there. And whenever a process, it has to go to a critical section, it checks while lock is true. So basically lock is applied, so it falls in an infinite while loop. Then it executes in its critical section. And before going in the critical section, it sets lock to be true, that now I have applied lock. It executes in its critical section and then sets lock equals to false. So there is no more lock applied. And every process does this. What was the problem with this? So just look at this solution. So we have discussed what is the problem with this. All the processes can execute in the critical section, right? And the reason for that is, if you look at this while loop. So whenever you look at these while loops, I want you to understand that, see, it's not just the critical section that when you are executing. So assuming that lock was not there, there was this portion of code which was being executed, which had a statement like count plus plus. And we said that this count plus plus, it is actually three assembly language instructions. So when we are executing those instruction, context switch can happen. The same applies to each part of your code, even to this while loop. How many instructions do you think it is? So if you look at this one line which says while lock equals to true, it is close to some four assembly language instructions. So it might look something to you like, let's say load lock in a register which let's say is R1, then you load this value true in a register which can be R2, Then you are comparing the contents of both of these registers R1 and R2, and then there is a jump instruction, right? So in case the output of this comparison it is true, so jump if equal it jumps back to this first instruction over here. So even this while loop which is executing here, it is for assembly language instructions and a context which can happen anytime. So you have no control over context which is on your system. It can happen anytime. So you can be here, a context which can happen. You can be here, a context which can happen. Okay. Then we know the problem with this. So when you are done with this jump instruction, so assume that it was not equal. And what will be the following instructions? After these four instructions, lock equals to true. So there will be again some three instructions here. So you might be loading the value of lock in a register R1. Then you would be changing the contents of this register R1 and storing log back. So store the contents of this register back in the variable log, something like this. So the idea was, when I'm done executing this instruction and assume this log was initially false, right? So the output here of this comparison instruction, so log equals to true. I'm going to come out of this while loop because log is currently false. So as soon as you come out of this while loop, before executing this load instruction, if you get a context switch, that was the problem. So at this point, we are context switching to another process. Lock is not yet set to true. So that another process, it is also going to see the value of lock to be false. It's also going to execute in its critical section. And then we have discussed the solution for that. The solution was a hardware solution such that we can bind both of these instructions together so that they happen atomically. So I don't want a context switch to happen after this while loop. So we talked about a test and set instruction, right, which will bind both of these together. And you can execute it like a single assembly language instruction. And then we came to semaphores. So semaphores is nothing but you can say it's a more generalized version of test and set. So in test and set, we were essentially using a lock, which was a Boolean variable, which could have two values, true and false. A semaphore variable, on the other hand, it can take any integer value. So let's say my semaphore variable, it is S. So I can initialize it with any integer value. So let's say 1. So I initialize it 1. If you initialize it with 1, it will act like a lock. If you initialize with something else, it will help you access shared resources. And then your wait and signal instructions, they were wait and signal functions, they were doing the same thing like your test and set instruction. So the idea is whatever is there inside these two functions, wait and signal, it will execute atomically. Okay. So we have a wait here. So every process, it waits on this semaphore, then it executes in its critical section and then it signals S. Okay, I'll come to the definitions of wait and signal in a while, but let's look at this is the general scenario. So the idea is, in order to achieve mutual exclusion, we have initialized this semaphore with 1. Now what happens? Wait S, it checks for the value of S. If the value of S is 1, it will make it 0 and continue. If the value of S is 0, it's going to wait. Right? So it is achieving the same thing as your lock. And it's easy to read this kind of program. So I just have a wait. So if another process is there in its critical section, this process is going to wait. Otherwise, it will execute in its critical section and it will signal that I am done with my critical section. Now I made a point there. The point which I made was this. In this case, if the definition of wait looks something like this, so what wait is having, it's also having a while loop. So while the value of S, it is less than or equal to 0, you keep waiting. Otherwise, you come outside and you decrement S by 1. With this definition of wait, we had a problem. What was the problem? So I told you that in case, assume that it is a low priority process which is executing. Right. And initially the value of S was 1. So this low priority process, it makes the value of S 0 and it starts executing in its critical section. when it was executing in its critical section. Now please note that when you are executing in a critical section, context switches can still happen. It's not that when I'm executing in critical section, no other process can execute. Context switch can still happen. What this semaphore stop is, they stop some other process to execute in their critical section at that time. So when this low priority process, it is executing in its critical section, still a context switch can occur, and your CPU, it can give your CPU can be given to this higher priority process. Now this higher priority process, it starts executing, and assume that it wants to go in its critical section. So it's going to call a wait on this semaphore, and it can't go further. Why it can't go further? Because currently this process is in its critical section. And then I made a statement that I cannot context switch back. So when I said that, when I said there that I cannot context switch back, this context switch is not happening, not because of I'm in an infinite while loop here. Even if you are in an infinite while loop, context switches can happen. I'm not context switching back because this is a higher priority process and this is a lower priority process. So if I'm using priority scheduling, I won't give my CPU back from a high priority process to a low priority process. This one will keep waiting for critical section to become free. This one cannot make your critical section free because it doesn't have the CPU. It cannot execute its instructions. So that was the problem we had. Okay. Another thing which I wanted to clarify. So look at this definition of wait S, which was our first definition. Rather, I'll write a star S here. So what we were doing is, while the value of this star S, it is less than or equals to 0, you wait. Otherwise, you decrement this value with 1. And we had signal star S, which simply increments the value of this star S. Something like this. So this definition was all right. Then I slightly modified this definition. And what I did was, I moved this line over here. So this thing, essentially, it comes and sits here, star S equals to star S minus 1. And I removed this equality condition from here. And I was only checking for whether it is less than 0, right? And I said that the behavior will remain the same. Actually, behavior will not remain the same. Can you see why? It will change. So if we try to make these changes, something wrong will happen. So we can do it, we can understand it with the help of an example. So the example is, let us say the initial value of semaphore, let's say it's a counting semaphore, so the value is 2. Two processes can be in their critical section at the same time. So what will happen? When the first process executes, it will make the value of S to be 1. So this is P1. It makes S equal to 1. S is not less than 0. P1 goes and starts executing in its critical section. So P1 is executing in its critical section. Comes P2. P2 again decrements the value of semaphore by 1. It now becomes 0. The value is still not less than 0. So far, so good. P2 also goes and starts executing in its critical section. So I now have two processes executing in their critical section. Then comes P3. P3 again decrements the value of semaphore by 1, and we know that it should not be allowed in the critical section. So it makes the value of S to be minus 1. The value is now less than 0. It goes and sits in an infinite while loop. So till now there is no problem. So if any more processes come, they will just keep decrementing the value of semaphore, minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, and all of them, they are waiting for the critical section. And this, the value of S, it is also telling me how many processes are waiting for the critical section. The problem comes when one of these processes, they actually come out of the critical section, right? So assume that P1 is finished with its critical section. It's going to call this signal operation on the semaphore. It's going to make the value of semaphore minus 2, right? Assuming that it was minus 3, three processes were waiting. Now the value becomes minus 2. And as you can see, one process can now enter in its critical section. Two could enter, so one has come out. Now one of these waiting processes, it could go inside the critical section, but it can't go. Why? Because still the value of S is minus 2 here, right? So no process will be able to come out of this while loop. Right, so progress is not ensured here. You have mutual exclusion, but progress is not there. Critical section is empty. Still, we are not allowing a process to go inside. So this approach does not work in case you are working with this while statement. But if you look at this other solution here, it works. So here also, if you look at this wait operation here, it is decrementing the value of s before, and after that it is checking whether s is less than, the value of s is less than 0. But this one works. Why? So here what happens is, whenever a process it comes out of its critical section, so if you look at signal operation here, if the value of s is less than or equals to 0, if the value of semaphore is negative, so I have this line here, wake up P, right? It wakes up one process from the queue. So this is what resolves that problem. So initially, whenever a process in this method here, whenever a process comes out of its critical section and the value of s is negative, we had no way to ensure that now one of those processes which was waiting should go and execute in its critical section. That was the problem here, which is resolved here with the help of the sleep and wake up signal system calls. Right? So now whenever the value of semaphore is negative and a process come out of its critical section, it's going to use that shared queue and it's going to wake up a process from there. Any doubts till now? Okay. Then let's move further and let's apply this concept of semaphore to one of the problems and try to resolve that. So we were talking about the producer-consumer problem. We'll just start with it again. So the idea was, you have a bounded buffer. Basically, you have an upper limit on its size. So let's say it can hold n items. Last time we were saying it can hold 4 items, but let's generalize it. So it's an array of size n, and the name of this array, it is buffer. So consumer, it is going to produce certain items, let's say certain integers. It's going to push them in the buffer. Consumer is going to take them out from the buffer. And I'm going to use one more shared variable, which instead of counter now, I'm calling it location. So location initially is 0. This location tells me where the producer, it is supposed to keep its next element. And then we have looked at the initial codes for producers and consumers. So what producer can do, while one, it can produce an item. So here I'm just putting in a comment here. So I'll just write produce here. So there will be some way in which it is coming out with that value of item. And after that, what it's doing is, buffer of location, it's going to place that item there and it's going to increment location. So this was the first rough code which we came up with. Same for the consumer. What consumer is doing, while one, it has to consume an item. So let's say it has another variable, let's say item 1, which it takes from location minus 1. So we have discussed why it is location minus 1 and not location here. And it will decrement this location by 1. Right? Okay. Then what was the problem with this? So there are two problems with this solution as of now. Right? So the first problem is, once this buffer is full, producer should not produce any more items. It should basically stop. In case the buffer is empty, consumer should not try to consume any more items. So for that, we have taken help of two infinite while loops. So we said that I'm going to put a while loop here, right? And while the value of log, it is equal to n, right? Basically, so this index is going to be n minus 1. The next index is going to be n. So if the value of log equals to n, producer keeps waiting. Similarly, if the value of log, it is 0, then consumer keeps waiting. So that's how we resolved the first problem. Then we had a second problem. Assume, what if there were this producer, it produced 2 items, 1 and 2, right? At this point in time, this while condition is also false. And this while condition is also false, because the value of location is 2, assuming n is greater than 2. Both of these conditions are false. So both producers and consumers, they can simultaneously enter their critical sections. These are 2 different threads. So again, we needed a synchronization primitive there. How can we achieve that? With the help of semaphores. So I am going to have a semaphore S, which you can initialize with 1. And now what I can do, I simply have to stuff some statements here. So before the producer, it tries to produce, it's going to call wait operation on this S. After it is done producing the item, it can call a signal on S. And your consumer, it can do the same thing. So before producing an item, it calls wait S. After producing, consuming the item, it calls signal S. So these wait and signal calls will now ensure that in case the value of lock, it is neither N nor 0, even then only one of these threads they execute in their critical sections. Okay, what is the problem with this approach now? Conceptually, it is all correct now. It gives me mutual exclusion. It gives me progress. It gives me bounded weight. Why does it give me bounded weight? So what I'm saying is this thread, it cannot happen that the producer is always producing and consumer isn't allowed to consume. Why does that happen? Can someone tell me? From the solution, it looks like, let's say the value of N is 10,000. So do you think that it can happen that a consumer gets executed 10,000 times, it produces 10,000 items, and during all this time, the producer produces 10,000 items, and during all this time, consumer, he doesn't get to consume any item if he wants to. It can happen? Possible. Okay. Any other answer? So remember what this wait S is doing. So assume that this producer, it has produced some 10 items, and after that consumer, it wants to consume an item. Right. So at that time, this consumer, it's going to call wait S. So 10 items produced here. Producer produced 10 items. Consumer wants to consume an item. So consumer says wait S, what will happen? What does wait S do here? So look at the definition of wait here. Yes. So first of all, it will decrease the value of semaphore by 1. That is all right. After that, what will happen? The value is less than 0. Right? The semaphore is currently negative. So this process, it is added to the queue. It is added to the list of the semaphores. We are maintaining a first in, first out queue. So there is a queue associated with a semaphore, just like there is a queue associated with a CPU with your input output devices. And that queue changes everything. So what will happen now? Whenever this consumer, it wants to consume an item and it expresses its interest with this wait S function here, this consumer, it is actually added to a queue. Right? And next time when this producer, it is done producing an item, it has to call signal S. Right? It cannot go in that while loop again to produce another item before calling signal S. So as soon as it comes out of its critical section, it calls signal S. And what does signal S do? It not only just increases the value of semaphore, it also wakes up a process from queue. And the consumer is there in the queue. Right? So this ensures bounded wait. It cannot happen that a producer keeps executing again and again. So think that there were these 10 processes and we had this implementation of a semaphore and all of them wanted to enter their critical section. With this particular implementation, it is not possible that one of these threads is going to starve. So the idea is whenever any other thread it wants to execute in its critical section, it will be added to this queue here, which we have named as list here. And whenever a process it comes out of its critical section, before going again in its critical section, as soon as it comes out, it's going to wake up a process from that queue. So all the processes in that queue, they are going to be served in a first in, first out order. Hence, there will be no starvation, as we have seen in CPU scheduling. So first in, first out scheduling can never lead to starvation. Starvation can happen with priority scheduling. Okay, we have all those three conditions met. We have mutual exclusion, we have progress, we have bounded weight. One problem which we yet have to resolve is, can you guess what? So whenever we write a code, we don't want statements like this, right? We have discussed about this before. So in our program, we never want to have such while loop sitting, which are waiting for a condition to become true, and the process is just waiting for that condition to become true. So unnecessarily, it is occupying the CPU again and again, and just coming back and checking whether the condition has now become true. So we want to get rid of it. In semaphores here, we have got rid of it with the help of this block call here. Right? So whenever a process it wants a critical section, it doesn't go in an infinite while loop. It blocks itself and it sits in a queue. It sits in the ready queue associated with this semaphore. We can use the same thing here. So whenever the producer it's not able to produce any more items, the buffer is full. It should not just keep waiting for the consumer. Okay, you consume one item and I'll put one item in. It should not basically check again and again. It should block itself. And how do we ensure that here? So instead of this while loop, I want to have a block call here. So whenever this producer, it cannot produce, it should block itself. Do you think in some way I can again use semaphores to achieve this? What should be my variable and what should be the value of weight? Where should I apply weight here and where should be signal? So let me put it this way. Here is your producer. Here is the part where it is producing an item. So this part is now in a critical section. We have already applied a semaphore for this. For consumer also, whenever it consumes an item, this is in the critical section. Both of these things, they are going to happen in a mutually exclusive way because of the presence of this semaphore, which was S. Now the point is, the producer, if the buffer is full, it shouldn't produce. And I want to write some code here so that if the buffer is full, right, this producer, it should go and sleep. It should not be there in an infinite while loop. How do I do that? Same is the case with consumer. So initially, if the buffer is empty and producer is just producing items, so consumer should not come back again and again and execute in this infinite while loop and keep checking that buffer is empty. At that time, I also want consumer should just come once. It should see, okay, well, the buffer is empty. It should block itself. Right? And then there should be some other code at some other place. Whenever an item is produced, it should signal back consumer. Okay, well, you can execute. How can I use a semaphore for that? Think about it. I'll give you some time. Now, the hint here is we are going to use counting semaphore for that. Come again.
The initial semaphore is the counting semaphore. The initial value of semaphore is the one to the end.
Okay, good. So
when it reaches zero, then you if the value of x is zero, then you block the producer.
Okay. If the value of x is zero, block producer. Okay. Let's look at this. So where should be weight and signal? So what this X here is telling me, it is initially N, right? So what is this actually telling me X is N? It is telling me, can I say that it is the number of empty slots in my buffer? So X is a variable which is telling me how much space I currently have in the buffer. So let me say it is space in the buffer, right? And what we are saying, if this space is zero, then I should block producer. Makes sense, right? So if this consumer is consuming everything and with time the value of x becomes zero, if there is no more space, I should block producer, right? So where should I have weight and signal statements now? Weight and signal statements for x. Who should reduce x and who should increase x is the whole question we are asking here. So this is the consumer here, right? Whenever it consumes an item, space increases, and whenever producer produces an item, space decreases. So can I say that I'm going to apply a weight x here and I can apply a signal x here? So what will happen now? Initially x is n. So whenever producer it wants to produce, it will decrease the value of x by 1 and then it will go ahead and produce. It wants to produce second time, it will again decrease the value of x, it will again produce. So over a period of time, when this value of x becomes 0, so this weight system call, this weight signal here, right? What will happen? It will block the producer and it will put it in the ready queue based on our implementation of weight. And now when consumer will start consuming, so whenever it consumes its signal x, it increases the value of x whenever it consumes an item. So in case this space has become 0, there was no space for the producer to produce, consumer, when it consumes an item, it signals x. And when it signals x, note that it will also wake up the producer based on our definition of signal here. Okay. The same thing I can do with the consumer also. So we can have one more variable, let's say y, which is initially 0. And what it is telling me? It's telling me the number of items. Please note that x and y, they are also shared variable. In your books, you might find a different name for them. It can be empty and full, so do not get confused. The concept remains the same, no matter whatever is the name of the variables. So the whole idea is x, s and y, all of these three variables, they are the shared variables. And now what will happen? It will happen in a reverse way. So whenever consumer, it wants to consume something, it will call a weight on y. Well, I'm going to consume something, so I'll decrease the value of y by 1. Number of items is going to decrease. And whenever this consumer, this producer produces anything, it can signal the value of y. So you can achieve this with the help of three semaphores here. So how is it going to look like this? Here I also have, if I look at the complete solution, here I also have weight s, signal s, weight s, signal s. And you have to be very careful with all these statements. If you interchange both of these statements here and both of these statements here, something unexpected can happen. We have to be very careful with all these weight and signal statements. If you interchange some of these, the entire algorithm will be disturbed here. Okay, so now with the help of semaphores, we have resolved all the problem. So we have achieved a perfect synchronization here. Okay, still there is one problem which remains with semaphores. So what this problem is, this problem occurs in case you are using a priority scheduling or any other scheduling which is related. So done with the semaphores, let us see what can happen. Now assume that there is a process with a low priority which is executing, right? And again, there is this process with a high priority which is executing. The same example which we discussed before in the context of infinite while loop. Now, the difference is only that we do not have an infinite while loop. Whenever a process, it cannot enter into critical section, it is blocked and it is placed in a separate queue. It is woke up by another process. Now, what can be the problem? Can there be a problem now? So let's say there was this low priority process. It was executing in its critical section happily, and then this higher priority process, it finished its input output, it came back to the ready queue, a context which happened. And now this higher priority process, it wants to execute in its critical section. What will happen? It won't go in an infinite while loop, it will be blocked, right? When it is blocked, it is no more in the ready queue. It's no more in the ready queue, then this lower priority process, it can execute and it can finish with its critical section. As soon as it is finished with its critical section, it will call signal which will wake up this higher priority process, and then that can also execute. So far so good. But sometimes what can happen? Now let's say let's have one more process here. which is having some middle priority here. So medium priority. So neither low nor high. And let's say this process, it doesn't have a critical section at all. It is just some other process which does not require any synchronization. It is independent. And this low priority process and this high priority process, they are the ones who are sharing a variable. What can go wrong here? So conceptually, nothing can go wrong, but some unexpected result can be seen here. So what will happen is, when this low priority process is executing, right, a context switch happens, you come to this high priority process. This high priority process, it now goes to the block state, right? It cannot further execute because low priority process was in its critical section. Who will get the CPU next? Low priority process or the medium priority process? Assuming we have a priority scheduling. Medium priority process, right? And this medium priority process, it doesn't even need to synchronize. So let's say now what happens? A context switch happened and now this medium priority process executes. And maybe in between, before this low priority process could actually execute, many medium priority processes come. Then what will happen? Before this high priority process, it could run. It is the one actually which should run according to our CPU scheduling. If there is a process which is having a high priority in my system, it should be served at the earliest. But what is happening because of these critical sections and all these blocking calls? So if it is blocked, low priority process cannot run. So assume that, so it's easy to imagine it. Let's say it's a very low priority and this one has a very high priority and somehow they are sharing a variable. If you have a context switch from very low priority to very high priority process, high priority cannot execute. It is waiting for this low priority process to come out of its critical section. And during all that time, this low priority process, it doesn't get the CPU at all. All these middle priority processes, they keep executing. And because of this, this high priority process, it could never execute. And it might appear like it's not a big problem, but it has been a big problem. So in, I think 1997, there was a Mars lander. So this spacecraft, it was supposed to land on Mars and it was supposed to send some photographs from there to Earth. And what was happening is when it landed well on the surface of Mars. And after that, the system, it had frequent restarts. So every now and then the spacecraft, it was restarting itself. So when people looked at it initially, they felt that might be there is certain overload on that system, but the actual reason behind that was this problem. So it was a real-time operating system. They were using priority scheduling. They were also using semaphores, but in exactly the same way which we discussed now. So what happened in that case, this high priority process, it could be the one process which is supposed to execute very frequently and also on a very high priority. It could be something which is, let's say, controlling the direction of your spacecraft, checking whether its engines are working perfectly and all those things. That's why it's on a very high priority. And there was this very low priority process. It could be the one which would periodically send photographs, right? So even if there is a delay in sending photographs, it is fine. And then there were these middle priority processes. So all these middle priority processes, and again, this low priority and this high priority process, they were using the concept of shared memory with the help of such semaphores implemented in this particular way. So all these middle priority processes, they were actually stopping this higher priority process from executing. And then there was one more process which would keep checking whether this high priority process, it is executing frequently or not. Right, so there would be a lot of checks. In case it is not executing frequently, it means that there is something wrong and that program would restart the spacecraft. So that was what is happening. Because of all these problems, high priority process wasn't executing and the system would be restarted again and again, thinking that there is some problem with the spacecraft. What is the solution to this? So can we do something here smartly to overcome this, to ensure that in case you have a context switch from this low priority process to high priority process, then before executing all these middle priority processes, we should execute this low priority process, right? Because this high priority process, it is being dependent on this low priority process for critical section. So we have a solution for that and it is called priority inversion. What we can do is, So whenever there is a high priority process, right, it calls a wait system call, wait function here. And this wait function, it sees that you are waiting for a low priority process and it is going to block itself after executing this wait. It's going to block itself. So before blocking, what we can do is this low priority process, you can change its priority. So for the time being, it can inherit the priority of the higher priority process. So whenever I implement this wait, and this wait, it is executing that statement block, which is blocking a higher priority process. So meanwhile, the lower priority process on which it is getting blocked inherits the priority of this higher priority process only for that duration. Once it executes its critical section and it wakes up this higher priority process, we again flip the priorities back. Okay. I think we are mostly finished with the process synchronization. Okay, few more things here. So look at this example. Let's say I have two semaphores, X and Y, as we had in the previous case. So the value of X is also 1 in beginning and the value of Y is also 1 in beginning. And you are trying to use these two shared variables. You are having two threads and you implement something like this. So thread 1, it calls wait X, it calls wait Y. Thread 2, it calls, let's say it also calls wait X, wait Y. So X and Y are the shared variables. Both of these execute in their critical section. After executing, you can have a signal X, signal Y. Same thing here. Is there a problem with this? So what will happen? X is initially 1, right? In case T0, it wants to execute in its critical section. It calls wait X. It will set X to 0, right? So the whole point you have to think of a context switch can happen anytime. So if a context switch does not happen, it will call a wait Y. It will make Y to 0, right? It will execute in its critical section and after that it will call signal. The value of X and Y will back be 1 and then this thread can execute. Okay, what if I had a wait X, it made it 0, and after that there was a context switch. What will happen? This thread is also calls wait X. Now the value of X is 0. Remember that wait X, wait Y, they'll always happen atomically. Right? So no context switching when I'm in wait X or when I'm in wait Y. Now when wait X is, it calls wait X, what happens? The value of X is 0. Right? So it will block itself. It cannot go further. So far, so good. It can again call wait Y, it can execute. But what if, let's say, someone messes up with this program and just slightly changes the value of this variable. I make a wait Y here and wait X here. You think what will happen in that case? None of them could execute. Right? What is happening? This one calls wait X, it sets it equal to 0. Let's say there is a context switch. This one will set Y equals to 0. This one, next it calls wait Y, it will block itself. This one, when it calls wait X, it will block itself. Both the processes are blocked. None of these can execute. None of these can call signal. They are just deadlocked. Again, you have to be careful with semaphore. So whenever you mess up with these wait X, wait Y statements, there can be unexpected things which happen. It's not a problem. It's not a conceptual problem, but it's a problem which can happen if the programmer is not cautious. So here it is the responsibility of programmer to sort of use all these semaphores in a good way so that no problem happens. So with semaphores, it's actually very easy to, you know, mess up. And if you do not, so there are so many wait X and wait Y, signal X, signal Y. What if I have 10 shared variables? All of this program, it's going to be very clumsy. And someone who doesn't exactly know how wait and signal work, they can end up making errors in such programs. So what people did was, they came up with this idea of something which is called a monitor. A monitor is the last topic in this unit. What is monitor is, So when this entire thing was being done, people were researching on process synchronization. At the same time, the concept of object-oriented programming was also coming up. And what is the use of object-oriented programming? Why do we use it? We can have a better real life implementations. It's easy to understand. It is more structured, right? And what is the biggest advantage there? So all the data which you are using, it is closely bound to the functions, right? So whenever you have to operate on any data, you cannot directly access any variable. You need to know the functions. Only with the help of those functions, you can operate on the data in case it is private, and we keep the data private most of the times. So they came up with this idea, if there is a way we can make this calling of semaphores here more structured so that it is easy on the mind of a programmer, and also make it available in the programming languages like Python and Java, so that the process of synchronization becomes easy for people. So that is the idea where Monitor came up with. It is nothing but exactly the same concept, but implementing it with the help of classes and objects. So the whole idea there is, what we do is, whenever I want to have any synchronization in my program, I have multiple threads. What I'm going to do is, I'm going to make a class, let's say a class X, and this class X, it will have all the variables which are being shared. So as an example, in the producer consumer problem, let's not talk about the variables as of now. So what it will do is, yes, we need the variable. So in the producer consumer program, what is being shared? It is the buffer, right? So there is this buffer which sits here, which is an array, let's say of length n. And the idea is, this variable which is sitting here, this one is the shared variable, and only one thread should execute it at one time. So you have certain functions here. I can have a function for consumer, which is consume, which will be doing something, right? And exactly the same code which we wrote here will be written here. So this code, right? Item equals to buffer location minus one, location minus minus. It comes and sits over here. And then there is one function for produce, which is producing an item in the buffer. And what was our first objective? It was that both of these should not happen at the same time. So the idea is, you encapsulate all of this in a class, whatever shared variable or variables you have, and the functions you want to perform on those shared variables. And then it is the responsibility of this class to ensure that exactly one of these threads can execute these functions at a time. So the whole point is, this monitor here, this class here, it is like a big black box. And inside this black box, it has a lot of functions, and only one thread can be inside this block at a time. It's not that two threads can use two different functions of this block, not even that. So if you are calling any function which belongs to this class, if any other thread is already executing some of the function of this block, you will be blocked. So only one of the threads can be inside this monitor at one time. In Java, you have a keyword for that. It is called synchronized. So whenever you are writing a function, if you append this keyword synchronize, so in a class I have a lot of function, you apply synchronize here, it will become a monitor by default. And now you can happily write your code. It is the headache of the programming language to ensure that no two threads can execute in the functions of that class at the same time. There is one more thing. So till now, so far so good, these consumer and producer functions, they cannot execute at the same time, but we are not still done with the implementation of this X and Y concept there. So when I talk about monitor from a high level perspective, its only function is to ensure that no two threads can be in the monitor at the same time. But in addition to mutual exclusion, as you have seen, we do various other things with semaphores, as in this example here, right? If you look at X and Y variables here, they are not ensuring mutual exclusion. Although they are semaphores, they are doing something else. They are helping in some other kind of synchronization. So they are ensuring that producer doesn't try to produce if the buffer is full. Consumer doesn't try to consume if the buffer is empty. So that implementation can also be done in this monitor with the help of something which are called conditional variables. So you can have certain conditional variables x and y here. They are going to be the conditional variables. Note that you do not need a s here. S in the previous example, we were using that to achieve mutual exclusion. Mutual exclusion will be by default provided by your monitor. No two threads can execute in its functions at the same time. I don't need an S, but I still need to have the implementations for X and Y. So the idea is, if someone is trying to produce, right, and the buffer is, let's say, full, it shouldn't be able to produce. So do you think, can I simply place a wait X here? Will it work how we had it previously? Let me change the name of the class here. So let's say the class is M. See, what we were doing here is, this producer here, it was calling wait X. X was initially N. So can I simply do that? In this monitor, I placed a wait X here. It will not work. Why? Because as we said, only one thread can execute in the monitor at a time. So let's assume that it was the producer thread which was trying to produce. Assume that the buffer is full and the producer is trying to produce. Consumer is nowhere in the picture as of now. So producer calls this function, right? The buffer is full and it will issue a wait on X. So when it issues a wait on X, this producer is blocked here, right? It cannot produce, it is blocked. When it is blocked, the problem here is now, consumer cannot execute. So as we said, right, producer is still here in its critical section inside the monitor. And we said that in the monitor, only one of the threads can be executing a function at a time. So you have some special calls to do that. They are also, I do not remember their exact names, but they also operate much like wait and signal. So what is the idea is, you can use some conditional variables, as in X in this case. You can call a wait on X. This is not the same wait as the before. So it is the wait associated with the monitor. So what will happen at this time, this thread which has called the produce function, it will go and it will be blocked. At the later time again, when a consumer, it consumes something, right, and it has consumed something, it can again call back a signal X. And this producer, it will be woke up at that time. So you need not worry much about the concept of monitors here, because in most of the programming languages, it is implemented directly. So you'll find it in Java, even in Python, I guess. But in C++, you don't have a concept of monitors as such. So if you have to have a class for monitor, you'll have to write it on your own. Okay, I'll just stop here. So we are done with synchronization. So most of the times you can achieve it with semaphore, and monitor is a high level language construct, which again you can use to achieve synchronization. Okay, so if there are any doubts, I'll take them up. Otherwise you can leave. Can you pass a sheet for attendance? Thank you.